Matt from New York. It's Ask an Engineer and a Mechanical Engineer.
Yeah, there's two engineers here. We got double your money. We got Electrical Engineer and Mechanical Engineer here at Adafruit in downtown Manhattan, where we're broadcasting live. So where we do all of our design and manufacturing and shipping and testing and kitting. And also got Mr. Lady Ada. He's an engineer in spirit.
I just work here.
He's the best engineering manager you'll ever meet.
I'm actually not a mechanical engineer.
You're not?
Well, you do mechanical engineering.
What would you say? What would you say your title is? Because you've been on the show,
industrial design.
Yeah.
Okay.
Everyone calls themselves engineers.
I make stuff that works.
You make stuff that works.
Oh, that you're not an engineer then.
Yeah.
Well, that's okay. You'll be our engineer in spirit. You know, I don't have a proper civil engineering license either.
For the folks who've watched Ask an Engineer for a long time, just search on our site. Look for the previous shows with Mike Dole, because we've gone over your portfolio, all the Raspberry Pi cases, the Arduino cases, all the work that you've done with us.
Times.
Yeah, so tonight we're going to talk about some robot-y stuff that you're working on with us, and then you're just going to hang out for the show.
Sure.
We're definitely not going to call you a CAD monkey. That would be terrible.
I've been called worse.
No,
okay. I'll be all right.
All right, so we've got an exciting show for you tonight, all sorts of CAD engineering and electrical engineering and products and news and videos and weird stuff. What's on tonight's show, Mr. Lady Ada?
On tonight's show, celebrating World Turtle Day, the code is World Turtle. 10% off in Adafruit store all the way up to 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time. Everything except for Ada Box and gift certificates. It supports us, an open source hardware company here in New York City, manufacturing, making electronics. We don't have loans, we don't have venture capital. We only survive because maybe you use this code and buy something in the store that helps all of us out.
Yay.
All right, show and tell, people around the world showing and sharing your project. Lady Ada will talk about some of the folks that were on the show and their projects. Back in the mailbag is going to stop by, read your letters to us. Time travel, look back in the world of makers, hackers, artists, and engineers. Have a fun one tonight. Main New York City, some factory footage, robot build, and more. 3D printing, new products. We got a little bit of top secret tonight. We're going to answer your questions in our Discord chat. You should go there now. That's where we see and hear everything.
Yeah.
Adafruit.it/Discord. At the end, we're going to answer your questions. And, of course, we're going to give something away at the end of the show. All that and more on, you guessed it,
Yay!
Ask an Engineer. Okay, Lady Ada, let's pay some bills and also go over some news-like things. First up, the code is World Turtle. But a little bit of a reminder, if you order something, Monday in the U.S. is Memorial Day, so there's no shipping until Tuesday. So if you order something after, Friday at 2, you might not ship till Tuesday.
But
so
that's
just
no big deal, because Monday is the day of Memorial.
Yeah. So just
it's a
keep
great
that,
country.
Just keep that in mind if you order stuff.
Go America.
Yeah, so if you're putting stuff in your cart, we still have the free deals. We've got PermaProtos, we've got Circuit Playground, and we have free UPS shipping.
Yep, at $99, $199, and $299, you get all these freebies, which is good stuff.
Yep, and of course, all the different forms of shipping, UPS, Postal, and DHL. One interesting thing, just another, you're in Canada.
Yep.
So we added DHL to our shipping method. Canada's number one, and then it's UK, Germany, France, and we ship things. It can leave on like a Tuesday and arrive sometimes a Wednesday or Thursday anywhere in the world with DHL lately.
Yeah, so, for me, if I order on a Wednesday, I get on a Friday usually.
That's pretty good.
That's
just
pretty
sales
sweet.
Through. So we've
it
been getting
a lot quicker than FedEx.
Yeah, there's FedEx, UPS, Postal, and DHL. They're not really a U.S. carrier. They're mostly focused on international.
Right.
And since we added that, we get our quarterly reports. So they're like 99.9 something percent on time or ahead of schedule. So that's worked out really well.
We ship all the stuff from China and DHL.
Yeah. It works.
That's what they're known for, but they're also really good at sending stuff out of the U.S. to other countries.
And we have same day in New York City. If you order before 11 a.m., it's one of the zip codes. You can get it same day.
Yes.
All right, Lady Ada, we do a show and tell every single week, 7:30 p.m. Eastern Time.
We did.
It's a show and tell. People around the world show and share their projects. And neat projects this week, some eco-focused ones.
Yeah, we had a lot of people show up.
Yeah.
Starting off with Scott, he wanted to announce the CircuitPython 3.0 beta. We'll talk about that in more detail.
Yep.
But that's very exciting. They just released that like today. He also is building a SAMD51 based Game Boy cartridge emulator. So he wants to emulate a cartridge so he can control the Z80 processor in a Game Boy Classic, like the old Nintendo handheld. JP talked about the guide that he made live this week for animatronic hands using servos and audio. So it's can count in binary and play games and you can control the fingers. So it's kind of fun. And then sneak peeked a unicycler papercraft bot that he's going to be making tomorrow in his live show, which is a little bit early, so check the blog post for the time, because it's moved up a couple hours just for tomorrow. Noah and Pedro are doing a lot of Cricut testing with the Cricut, which is a cutting robot, and they're doing papercraft makies, adding servos to make them interactive, tips and tricks on how to use 3D modeling with these paper cutting robots to make cool 3D printed shapes. These robots are much less expensive than laser cutters or 3D printers. You can get them for a couple $100. So it's like, yeah, if there's some project you can build with them, like,
you can use a Cricut to make enclosures for your Cricut, yeah, and you can make Crickets.
Yeah.
Cricket.
Is that the one you get at Michael's? That cuts,
yeah.
The...
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Okay. Yeah, it's neat. We got one over there.
Yeah. Mike B. Previewed a Rob the Robot with Circuit Playground Control. He's going to be writing a guide on that, so check that out. Erin is running a Kickstarter for Bowie, her environmental trash bots. These robots run along the beach in Toronto and pick up trash, and they use a neural net to recognize when trash has been detected. So they're kind of, you know, they're kind of neat. They're very advanced robots, and they have a goal. They have a cause, which is to reduce environmental trash. So check out the Kickstarter for the Bowie robot. I think the link is probably going to be in the video. So I think she posted it. Mm-hmm. Isaac is building a composter turner. So he made a model using like a tin can and some like Lego components to turn the compost to aerate it to reduce the methane and to make it compost faster. And then Computer Pro had a hard drive disk issue, but then got an SSD, which is awesome, and made two new channel bots. One is a permission bot that on Discord helps you manage, set, and change permissions, and then made a robot that's an escape server game, so you can like have a cyber escape room. Like, you know, the escape rooms where you have to do puzzles, but you don't have to even leave your house. You can just do it on Discord. JMK is making a Wi-Fi controlled sign that'll spin a servo, and one side says come in and one says don't come in, so you can put outside, yeah, his room, and so people know whether or not they can come into his room, and using little bits. Rebecca came by and is working through her Ada Box 4, and she's hacking on the audio player, and the audio player could do Wi-Fi or SD card, and she's going to try to make one that does both. So good luck to her. That would be kind of cool. You can choose whether you want to use Wi-Fi for audio playback, or you can do the SD card playback. Techniac made a coaxial piston t-shirt air gun. It's a very interesting, complicated project where the air is contained. You don't have like a separate air container. It's inside the gun, and it's like the air is around it, and then it pushes out. I don't completely understand it, but it looks really cool. And for
shoot marshmallows
or t-shirt, very big marshmallows.
Yeah. Does it make them big, or do you need big marshmallows?
I don't know. I mean, maybe just
you
get
can always
of
construct
bread.
A larger marshmallow out of lesser marshmallows.
Oh, we should make a mold and cast large marshmallows.
Okay. All right. Okay, that was the show and tell. All participants on the show and tell get an Essene on the show and tell sticker, email support at adafruit.com, and we'll send you out one. This is part of our Adafruit live series of shows. Tomorrow, John Park, as Lady mentioned, is going to be showing some cool stuff. I have a few clips from some of his projects. We're just going to play those real fast.
Medium. Moist.
Okay, so that's tomorrow. Look on the blog for JP's show, and you'll see all these cardboard experiments and more. Pack the mailbag. We read these letters to... Mike, were you ever at a State of the Fruit? Were you ever here on a Friday night?
Yeah.
You were. Yeah, so every Friday, we do all the stats of the company and everything. And then we do these emails that come in. So this was one that Lori sent in. I heard the piece about Adafruit in New York Radio Hour and was fascinated. We just began a STEM class in my school, and I was totally inspired by the way that engineering was discussed. I'm going to share it with our STEAM teachers for sure. Keep up the awesome work, Lori. Thanks, Lori.
Thanks, Lori.
Yeah, and another little shout-out, because we do hug reports at the end of State of the Fruit. So Stella, our CFO, is in Discord, and also Brent, who's done a lot of work with us, did the Metro X Guide.
Yeah.
So hug reports to them. I always said if you have a company and you have, you know, CFOs and CEOs and CMOs, they should be as active and as part of the company and the community as possible, and we have that, so it's cool. I don't know any other companies that have their CFO in the Discord chat with the live electronic show with like 5,000 people.
I don't chat with her. I get a lot of email from her.
Yeah, you chat with Stella, but that's always neat when you can, you know, here's the people who actually run the Adafruit. So thank you everyone who's here, and of course our community support and publishing team who's here every week, and all of the moderators in Discord and everyone who keeps us a cool place. We'll have some interesting Discord news soon too, but that's probably for next week. Okay, we have a Make Code thing I wanted to show.
Yeah.
So Make Code added this neat feature. One, go to makecode.adafruit.com if you have a Circuit Playground Express and plug it in, drag and drop block programming, JavaScript stuff. And since we do a lot of videos, I was emailing with the Make Code folks. And I said, is there any way to do like green screening so I can take the programming interface and get rid of, you know, every time you see a programming tutorial, or actually you've probably seen like CAD tutorials, and
it's like a big screen.
It's a giant screen. And there's this little tiny head behind it.
Yeah.
So there was a neat JavaScript thing that you could put in the address bar that would turn the background green. And that was like that was a first start. So we did a little video and they're like, oh, that's kind of neat. And so now that's a feature in MakeCode where you can turn the background into a webcam so it can use your camera that's on your computer, or you can turn it into a green screen. So when you do instructional learning, or if you were doing even a video call and you wanted to teach programming, or you just wanted to record how-to videos, MakeCode does that now. So I have a little clip from JP, because now we're using that for his shows and for our tutorials.
So On Loud Sound is a loop that will do something that you stick inside of it when a loud sound is detected. I'm going to head up to light and grab this show animation block and drop it in here.
See?
A little animation played there for half a second. So now I can say, you know what, I want to get this fire colored one and let's get it going for about a second. And then after I snap my fingers and make that animation happen, I'm going to go to a different light pattern. Oh, this thing's right in my face, isn't it? So we'll do lights, and I'll just grab this show ring, which is a really nice visual way to pick some colors. It's here and there. I like that. So now I'll do is swap this over to the On Loud Sound. And now I'm going to, I've got this named down here at the bottom. I'm going to hit download. And now, there we go. So on snap.
Okay.
Amazing.
So I thought we'd do a quick 3D printing video, and then we would then talk to Mike, and then we have a lot of stuff tonight.
We do, yeah.
So I wanted to do the first one, and this is Noah and Pedro's project that they just put this week. It's the Papercraft Makey robot from Maker Faire.
Okay. We'll be right back.
Okay. That was my segue into 3D stuff.
Ooh.
So, Mike, maybe tell us a little bit about yourself. You have a website. You're an industrial designer. Just for the folks who haven't seen every single Ask an Engineer.
I had a pitch.
What do you do?
What do you
do? I design products. I used to own an injection molding company, so I end up doing a lot of plastic parts, you know, things that click together, a lot of mass-produced stuff, some steel. Lately, I've been working on vehicles, so I worked on an electric car, electric truck.
You worked on medical stuff? Like, I've seen, like...
Yeah, so a lot of medical, what you call it, not just small devices, but cabinet-style stuff, and OR-related stuff, so... kind of a mix. Being in Toronto, you don't really have a say. Like, there's not a lot of manufacturing, so you sort of have to take what comes along. So as a result, I do a lot of variety. Started out doing running shoes, a lot of small stuff for you guys, little plastic things.
For Adafruit, you've done Pi cases, Arduino cases.
Cufflinks.
The cufflinks, that was a fun project.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had the first ever LED cufflinks that pulsed.
That was because of your Mac breaking down or something.
Yeah.
I think it was you sent a power button. And so what can
I saved
this?
The power button. I'm like, one day this will be a cufflink.
Yeah. I actually can't remember. And mostly variations of Raspberry Pi cases, things with touch screens and some buttons, which I noticed while I'm here this week, you're using a lot for testing the Pi TFT with the
Oh, that's right. Buttons. We did the Pi TFT case.
Yeah.
A lot of test rigs set up with that.
So you're here out this week, and I have this image on the screen, and we'll go to your laptop in a second. But one of the things that we've been waiting for, I don't know, like at least a decade, was let's finally bring robotics, low-cost, high-quality robotics that everyone can use, everyone can do, but the programming wasn't there yet. There wasn't anything like CircuitPython. Computers were the only way to do it, and eventually there was development boards, but that's still really tough. So now we have Cricut, our robotics platform. So now we're like, okay, we have all these motors, all these servos, and we're back to the previous challenges. Everything is hard to use, expensive. How do you connect all this stuff together?
Right.
So this is one of the prototypes that you just whipped up in the last day. But you're working on servo horns and a few other things. So let's go to your laptop. What stuff have you started cooking up?
So
this is all coming soon, by the way, everyone.
Yeah. Well, we started looking at things.
We started yesterday.
with the steppers all being proprietary. So the splines are the sort of gears, the driving systems are all different.
Yeah, so that's the DC motors we have in our store. And those are pretty well known. Like, if you go on YouTube, there's a billion projects for them. But all the projects, the challenge is how to get the stuff fitting to the stuff.
How to get
to
it
make
to fit.
It, yeah,
right.
And then you have to make it move.
Right, so that was one of the things we're talking about today, is finding other components. Instead of reinventing everything, taking things like Lego components and making them fit with servo motors. So a lot of common, not Lego type, like sort of like Mindstorms, I guess, but... common elements that are affordable and easy, you know, instead of, I'm thinking like Meccano. Do you remember Meccano?
Yeah.
Does anyone remember Meccano?
Yeah.
And just a common set, and maybe something we can expand upon, you know, over the next year or so. And things where we're changing directions. So we're talking, it was a Dan today saying that instead of just having something coaxial, change the orientation relative to the axis of the motor, things like that. So I had originally planned, I'd forgotten my iPad in the hotel, but last night I was drawing furiously, and I'm glad I forgot it, because it would have been a lot more work than what I did today, because we would have been 3D printing till Sunday. So because I forgot it, I ended up doing things using laser cut parts today, which was really quick to iterate. So I got to go through a lot of variations, and I made a ton of mistakes quickly, failed really quickly, so that was great. Oh, my screen's up now. Okay.
Yeah,
so
you're showing it.
This is kind of hard to show hard to get a sense of scale because I don't have a banana in it. But you can see that initially I thought, because of stability, I was going to have three legs. And these are about 6 inches tall, roughly. So my original thought was just to have two. And of course, it worked in my head where there's no gravity, so it didn't fall over. And then when I mocked it up, I thought, you know, I should make something wider. The problem was that.
What is this?
What is this?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. So going back to our original discussion when I was talking to Phil about a robot, I wanted to do something. I was thinking of an old horror movie, and I still can't remember the name of it, with a hand. It was a severed hand that would follow people.
The chat room will probably be able to figure
it
out.
Yeah, I can't think of the name.
Do you know what that old movie with the hand that chased you was?
It would be like the 40s or 50s or something.
Not the hand. Not the severed hand.
Yeah. So I thought it'd be really cool to do a hand. And I thought of that again when we saw John's hand during the show and tell. So then that got me thinking of making something that crawls or sort of moves like a worm, I guess, for motivation or to move. So that's why I came up with, I'll switch into CAD first and I can come back.
Yes. Yeah.
So I'll just show you quickly in SolidWorks here. I'll shade this up. So just using the Cricut and the Circuit Playground and a few, these aren't servos.
These are DC motors.
DC motors, okay. The reason I used, I don't know a lot about servos and motors and things, but the reason I use these is because they have a shaft comes out both sides of the motor. So I thought for stability, I could add a wheel on either side of the device.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so then we started laser cutting some parts, you know, the gray and the yellow, and putting in things like space or accommodations for zip ties to hold the motors in place. And with this layout, we can also put a stepper in, and still with the longer slots, you can still hold a stepper or different types and shapes of motors,
mm-hmm.
which is one of the things we're looking at for the modules also. What was the motor we were talking about yesterday, the round DC?
There's stepper motors, there's DC motors, and there's servo motors.
But remember the large diameter one? I can't remember the name of it. It was, anyway, so having a motor mount for that. So once you get out of laser cutting into injection molding, we can have more common mounts. So we can attach motors to other motors and then get crazy
and axes,
some weird articulation.
And each motor has its own, or each servo has its own like pros and cons, like continuous rotation servos.
Right.
Those are neat, but you really can't, unless they're expensive, know exactly where it is. Then there's standard servos, which you can. And then there's DC motors, super cheap, but they're kind of only go forward and back. And you can, there's tricks and things you can do. What I like the way you're approaching this is, depending on your application, you can have three standard servos, and that can make a robot arm or a robot snake. Or you can have
Multiple wrists.
Yeah, this vehicle that you know this is kind of can inch along, and you can keep adding to it based on the.
But there was another motor you mentioned earlier today. Something about memory. I can't remember the name.
We have servos that you can. It's a little bit of a trick. You can record the
recording,
motion.
That's what it was. Yeah.
And it neat for animatronics, or if you wanted to make something like a signing robot that signs your name, or if you don't want to program all the movements of servos, that's a neat trick to do.
But could you get it to sort of optimize? So if you ran it through a set, could you fine tune it afterwards? Or maybe not by itself, but could you go through and optimize the code a little? And
you might use that recording to get started, and then like base your code around that.
Yeah, you give a graph, and then you can.
Okay.
You know, you can graph it and you
put
can
put it in TensorFlow.
Turn it into an algorithm or something.
I just wanted to say, put it in
it.
TensorFlow.
Okay, MATLAB.
Just there's a lot of powerful tools now that can do the quick iterations to figure out like, oh, is that a picture of like a horse or. A soda can. So there's a lot of processing power. So there, you see that in a lot of robotics for like AI, where it's like quickly going through that. Okay, so you've got this, and you actually made a prototype. Do you want to? We can go to the overhead real quick.
You have to close your computer.
Okay, let me get this out of the way here.
Okay, so we have this, and so you made this already.
Yeah, made this today. Not knowing what I was making when I came in this morning, I ended up with this.
Okay.
This is not what I intended.
Yeah. So this is just a few hours of tinkering, but you've got a prototype. So this weekend, Lady A and I are going to put servos on this and maybe make a little robot.
So I don't know if we can see from here how it works. Basically, it would inch along. I guess I can't orient it that way. So I don't even know how you would explain that. This one would rotate away, and then the other one would catch up, I guess.
Yeah. Like in the top one, we could probably use like a standard servo, and it would just hold in the position.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And then the other ones could inch around.
And I think I mentioned it earlier, and it's probably not possible. I'd like to see a jump, kind of creepy, like a spider. You know,
they
jump
ideas.
Up at people.
There's ideas. You could do it.
Do a wheelie.
Yeah, we're gonna be showing some robot gymnastics later tonight. So anything's possible now.
Hey.
Anything's possible.
Okay.
Okay. Well, that's what you're working on right now.
Yeah.
Inchbot.
There we go. We've got a name. We'll trademark it.
Okay. Well, for the folks out there to show, as we get some of these 3D renderings or some of the ideas, we'll probably post some coming soon to get some feedback from the community.
Right.
But one of the ideas is like you get a model set and you just snap off all the different types of servo horns you need.
Like an old model kit, yeah.
Yeah, like an old model kit. And right before the show started, one of the things we talked about is there's no servo horn that's like 3 inches in diameter that has like standard bolt size or screw size. That would be so useful, and all the things that are out there are like, they're milled, they're metal, it's like $80 and it's for like really intense mm-hmm. robotics. We just want like low cost, easy to use stuff for kids, and like you just get like, how much would a sheet of servo horns probably end up retailing? Like 10-15 bucks or something.
Not
like
a lot, no.
Yeah, and like,
but it's like 10 cents of plastic, you know, it's just yeah. the hard press designing it.
And right now, like, I've been sampling all these different servo horns from all these different robotics companies, and it's like $12, $20, $30, and it's like three, and I'm just like, there must have been a mistake.
Yeah,
yeah, that doesn't make any sense. Those parts are like 30 or 40 cents to make.
Okay. All right, well, folks who have questions about industrial design, and they'll probably ask what tools you use and some other stuff, same for the end.
Okay.
Because that's what you're always going to get asked. What's your favorite tool?
What's your favorite CAD software?
What's your favorite CAD software?
Fineliner, pencil, or pen.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, so we have some big news in the world of CircuitPython, Lady Ada.
Yes.
Maybe you could talk about this. Congrats to Dan, Scott, and Katni.
And the whole team.
Dean, the community. And you know what I like about when we launch anything with CircuitPython? There is an entire like thank you list in GitHub.
And it's long. I don't remember all the names, so I don't even want to try to list them all.
Do you have the printout that I got for you?
No.
Because it had all the features of...
I don't remember any.
Oh, okay.
But it's okay. I kind of know what the
features are. Do you know what they all
are? Yeah, in 3.0, we definitely... we've changed audio, so you can now play and pause audio. The memory management has changed to be to work a lot better for the small chips that we're using. We have a preliminary NRF52832 support. We have...
fresh from the newsroom.
Improved RTC precision on the SAMD21 thanks to Notro. We have the temperature module, so you can read the temperature of the chip itself on SAMD21 and SAMD51. Micro bin ASCII and micro collections have now been matched to CPython, so now they're just bin ASCII and collections. We have I2S out support, so if you want to do audio with I2S, you can do it. BitBang IO is a little bit more flexible. Some makefile improvements, document improvements, Sphinx improvements. Supervisor reload, you can reload the virtual machines. There's some background stuff. Improvements, tweaks to Trinket and M0 to not take as much memory. We now have singleton objects for I2C, SPI, and UART. This is kind of interesting because everyone keeps making the same default bus devices, thanks to Matt Land, who's like, you know, we should just have singleton devices, and everyone's like, you know what, you're right. So we do. So if you want I2C, it'll generate the default I2C if it's available. We now have long int support in M0 express boards, and of course in M4. More M4 stuff, touch IO in M0. And we have a custom board for the Circuit Playground Cricut. We're doing a lot of experiments to really optimize the Cricut build of Circuit Playground for robotics. So all the robotic stuff is built in. So motor support and the seesaw support. So you don't have to take up memory or disk space. It's cooked in. So you can actually get started without dragging any files over. You can just start writing code and everything.
Just like how easy it is to do stuff with NeoPixels. Imagine if it was that easy to do with robotics. And you can.
Yeah.
So that's why we did that. Okay.
And even more stuff just in 3.0 in general. Just a big cleanup. A lot of stuff has been updated and improved. So we're now in beta, which means that we are aiming to have implemented everything in 2, in 3. So for all the boards that were supported in version 2, version 3 support should be complete. Everything that you can do in 2, you can do in 3. And then there's stuff that you can do in 3 you couldn't do in 2 because, of course, it's better.
Yeah.
So if you're running CircuitPython, we ask, please try upgrading to 3.0 beta. It looks pretty solid. I've been using it a lot. You've been using it a lot.
Yep.
And we're going to head towards release very soon.
Yeah, and we've been using Moo as our editor. There's been a lot of updates with that. Entol and his team is doing a ton of updates. I think they're almost finished with the automatic generation of the Mac versions that's already working with Linux and PC, and I think Pi as well. So it's an excellent time to start doing robotics, any type of programming. I really like how fast you can iterate with code.
For the robotics, it really helps because, we calibrating stuff, tweaking stuff, we just save it and iterate. I mean, we have to do 50 minor revisions as we do every robot.
Yeah.
Oh, move the servo a little bit less. Like, if it was an Arduino, you'd have to do a full compile cycle. In CircuitPython, I'm like, oh, I'll just subtract 10. Is that good? No, add another 5 until we get to the exact right values that we want. It's very fast and efficient for robotics.
Okay. And you can also go to learn.adafruit.com/category/CircuitPython or on our Discord, adafruit.it/Discord, for by the second, by the minute, CircuitPython stuff. We're wrapping up our Moo series. So Moo's that editor we talked about. It's a great code editor for beginners, but it's also very powerful. It does plotting, has REPL, has everything built in. So this is our soil moisture sensing video with Moo.
And plants.
Are graphing with the plotter, featuring CircuitPython and Moo. Today, we'll be graphing soil moisture. You can use the Circuit Playground Express to measure soil moisture in order to keep your plants happy and healthy by indicating when they need to be watered. You can program the Circuit Playground Express with CircuitPython and graph the moisture level with the plotter in Moo. The capacitive touch pads on the Circuit Playground Express report higher levels of capacitance in wet objects and lower levels in dry ones. We've built a moisture sensor by connecting an alligator clip to a common nail in one end and the capacitive pad on the other. When we put the nail into dry soil, it gives us one reading. If we take the nail and put it into wet soil, we get a much higher reading. We can enter these high and low values into the code so that the NeoPixels will light up green to indicate moist soil, orange when it's getting dry, and red when it's definitely time to water the plants. By printing these values to the plotter in Moo, we can create a graph of moisture levels over time. And that's all there is to graphing soil moisture on the plotter in Moo.
Okay, and of course we have our awesome CircuitPython list. We're submitting that to the awesome list, so you'll be able to get all these resources in one spot. It's part of our weekly Adafruit Daily series. You know what's interesting? Because this is in the news. You know how you're getting a million emails about GDPR, Europe, privacy stuff? So the whole entire world is freaking out because, like, the deadline's this week. But one of the cool things is we did our privacy policy, and we've never taken people's private information. If you want to sign up for a newsletter, it's a separate site. We respect Do Not Track. Someone on Hacker News, which is usually not the friendliest place in the world, they were like, there's no examples of Do Not Track, and they're like, actually Adafruit does. So if you have Do Not Track turned on, the YouTube video doesn't play. It says like Do Not Track's turned on. So it was really neat to look at our privacy policy, make sure it's going to be compliant with all the EU regulations coming up. And because we don't have like pop-ups and like newsletters that you're forced to do, and like we don't profile you and all that stuff, it was very easy to do. You can go to Adafruit Daily if you want and sign up for our daily newsletter. There's Maker Business, Biohacking, Electronic Tips, Cosplay, Wearables, and of course, Python on Hardware and more. Okay, I was looking forward to this. We have some cricket videos.
That's our mascot.
Yeah, Cricket the Cricket. So every day, because we run a company, so we have like a little bit of time. So there's some constraints with what we can do. So it's like the project can only take like a half an hour to make and like a half an hour to film. And we have really great videographers, but we can't do that because it's like a big photo shoot. It's a big shoot and there's like lights and sound and like, okay, everybody, like no weekend plans this weekend. We're going to film like a full Circuit Playground cartoon series with live action puppets or whatever. So the constraints are I can use my iPhone to film it. And Lady and I go through and we test the different features of Cricket because we're in the middle of launching Cricket. So we wanted to do like an open source voting machine. We want to do all these things. But instead of just testing it and saying it worked and having it like on a... I always see these robotics projects and they're like, look at all the stuff it does. And it's just on a giant breadboard. It's like, well, you can imagine one day it being interesting and all the functionality is there, but there's no application. So we watched the news or the tweets and there was that Laurel or... Yanni thing. It's like, which one do you hear? So we're like, oh, we can do something with that. So let's play the video.
Hello, I am Cricket. I will say a word and you can select what you hear. I will say it 3 times. Press the button next to what you hear. Ready?
Yanni. Yanni. Yanni.
Thank you. Your observation has been logged to my USB memory to a data file CSV. Hello, I am Cricket. I will say a word and you can select what you hear. I will say it 3 times. Press the button next to what you hear. Ready?
Larry.
Thank you. Your observation has been logged to my USB memory to a data file CSV.
Okay, and the next one we have is we wanted to, and this was kind of coincidental, there was a Disney Imagineering video that came out yesterday, and we had started on our robot trapeze, and we thought, wouldn't it be neat if you can use the accelerometer inside of a circuit playground, know when it's at the top of an arc, and then let go of a little robot to do robot trapeze.
Yes.
So we did that one too. Okay, and then a few other things we want to test is, well, really portable robotic projects, sometimes you don't have wires connected to it, so could you use like a remote control or something? So we showed how to do that. We're also thinking, well, if you have a robot that lights up, you can also take cool photos of it with NeoPixels and do like light art.
Yeah.
So a little robot that does that. So we have a...
And you want a blimp.
And we wanted to make a blimp. That was the other thing. So here's the next one.
I am Cricket. Press forward to move the fan forward. Press back to go in the opposite direction. To turn off the fan at any time, press stop. As you spin me, I will say yeah and light up LEDs on the NeoPixels. You can take photos in the dark of the lights with long exposure to make hard to share. Fan going forward. Fan going backwards. Fan stopped.
And then last up, we wanted to make sure, what if you wanted to use it for making art? And we had the spinny bot that we made where you pour paint, but we didn't test out the foot switch. So we thought, well, would it be neat to do some type of foot switch plus something spinning, plus maybe NeoPixels or maybe having audio? Maybe when you press the switch, the audio speeds up. And
you also connecting stuff to the signal port, so you can have like potentiometers and stuff to adjust your project.
Yeah. So we thought, like, okay, here's all the things that we want to test. How can we combine that into one thing and then make a video about it? So so we have that with a surprise ending too.
time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much for you, still more I need to know.
And that's all the things that you can do with Cricket and more. We'll be posting more of those videos throughout the week. Time travel, back to the world of makers, hackers, and artists and engineers. I have a trivia question for the both of you.
Yeah.
Which U.S. president is the only U.S. president that has a patent?
How would I know?
How would you
I'm
know?
Canadian.
How would you know? Our neighbors to the north. You,
jeez.
You could, I don't know.
Abraham Lincoln? I don't know.
Good guess. You got it.
Yeah.
Lincoln, the only U.S. president.
I vaguely remember hearing about this. It was in the back of my brain. But what is it
yeah,
for?
Yeah, and so this was from, we have the date because it's time travel, 1849. This was for this boat lifter thing. So the invention stemmed from Lincoln's experience of ferry traveling, carrying freight on the Great Lakes and some Midwestern rivers in 1860. Lincoln wrote in his autobiography and recounted that while in his late teens, he took a flatboat down the Ohio and Mississippi rivers from his home in Indiana to New Orleans. He was employed as a hired hand. The boat company went on to do other things, and then he decided to sketch this out, and he got a patent for it. So, yeah, and here
it's number 6469.
And it's in the Smithsonian. And they built a model of it, and here you can look up the Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah.
Not only did he like slay vampires and everything, but because there was a movie about that, but he also, you know, did patents. So, okay. Yeah. Lady Ada, we have some tutorials this week.
We do. I'm over here, so you're just going to make a little
Yeah, cake. We have the Adafruit Pi Key.
Yeah, there's a new product, coming soon product. We've upgraded the IR key, which was a microcontroller, infrared to USB converter, to now use CircuitPython. So it basically uses a SAMD21 processor. So it's really customizable. You can program it, change and adjust it to make infrared signals. Once they're detected, type keys, move the mouse, all sorts of good stuff. Okay. But it's a special little dongle.
Installing Microsoft Make Code?
That's by Brennan. So this is for people who want to run their own Make Code server. So some people say like, oh, what if I don't want to use the Microsoft cloud-based Make Code server? I want to run it on my own. Maybe I want to run it on a Raspberry Pi. Maybe I don't want to leave my network. You can run it locally. You don't have to use the cloud. It's just convenient because you don't have to follow these instructions. We also have instructions on how to install it in a Vagrant in case you ever want to do development on a web server. So it's useful. We use it in-house because we're doing MakeCode development.
And we already showed the video, but this is the guide for the animatronic hand.
Yep. You get 4 servos, some cardboard, some straws, and some string, and you can make your own hand to count numbers, or you can control them with other servo, other signals and sensors. You can play rock, pick, paper, scissors, all sorts of good stuff.
Storage, humidity, temperature monitor.
This is by Dave Estelles. This is a little project using, I think, as a Trinket and a TPL 5110 temperature sensor, and just doing really low power humidity monitoring. It beeps, I think, when the humidity goes above or below a certain level. But it's just very, I think it's in Arduino. I don't think it's in CircuitPython, but it uses the TPL 5110 to make it ultra low power.
Okay, there was the Living Starry Night painting.
That's one of the projects that you did. It was like our first project we did, the Cricket. It just turns the Starry Night painting into an interactive art piece. This adds some LEDs into it that twinkle in the background. A great write-up by Dano. He's learning how to use CircuitPython in Cricket, so this is a good beginner project.
Mickey Mickey Papercraft?
It's Noah and Pedro's project that we showed the video of, how to use a quick cut, or you can cut yourself a servo-waving Mickey robot.
And then last up was Pyglass. This is a wearable Pi Zero.
Yeah, this this project has been on Show and Tell a couple times, and there's a guide write-up, so if you really love making your own wearables and you're just like, I'm ready to take on a project, this project takes a Pi Zero camera, modules, and a lot of work and craftsmanship, but you can make your own glass-mounted wearable using a Raspberry Pi.
Okay. More tutorials ahead. We have some Made in New York City videos, and then after that, new product. So here
okay.
we go. Take it away, us. And every single night, our picket place is go to sleep, and this is one of the many sunsets they saw outside the Adafruit factory windows this week. Okay, Lady Ada, AdaBox is going to be shipping soon. If people didn't get their AdaBox, get your AdaBox.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Calling AdaBox.
Yeah.
Save our city.
We just finished shooting Ennis for Noise. Colin's editing that right now. And I'm like, hey, we should do like kind of a bat symbol type thing for AdaBox.
Look how Blinka is just like shocked.
And it's like, what?
What? Huh? Is happening?
So, all right. Okay, well, before we do new products, Lady Ada, the code is World Turtle for World Turtle Day. Here we go.
New.
Okay, first up, we got a book.
Got a book, Ada Twist Scientist. This is a fun book. That it's kind of like a large picture book with beautiful drawings. It's for kids, but you know, maybe you have kids so you can read it.
Yeah, Danny, a new product review. He's like, this is a good book. We should talk.
Yeah, it's a nice book. It's got rhymes, and it's about a young girl named Ada. And there's a sticker. And she's really creative, and she likes to build stuff. And she always asks questions about why things are, and she likes to make Mentos and Coke exploding things, and she likes to play with radios and telephones and clocks, and she's just creative and constructive. So I think it's just these beautiful, beautiful drawings and a wonderful story about Ada Twist. How does the story end? You're going to have to pick up the book to find out.
It's a twist ending.
It's by Andrea Beattie and illustrated by David Roberts. Ada Twist Scientist. So we love carrying books that we think are inspiring to young makers. Yep. So if you have a young maker you know, maybe they would appreciate this book.
Okay, next up.
It's a black rectangle. this is a item that was in Ada Box 7. It's a really nice metal security, a camera security slide. So I'm going to show it just sort of like this. So it's got this really strong glue on the back, and if I removed this blue plastic, then I would be able to stick it on the back. And then it's got a little groove that when you just slide your finger over it, it stays where it's at, but when you rub your finger, you can open it up or close it. And it's just the right size for tablet, phone, or laptop, like built-in cameras. It's not gonna work with your gigantic Logitech camera that sits on top of your monitor.
No, but the sneaky built-in ones, which you want to cover, that's what this is for.
Yeah, and it's super skinny. So a lot of these camera covers that we got samples of were like really thick plastic. This one is ultra thin. So even if you have like the fanciest new Apple MacBook or Dell or Yoga Book or whatever, it will close. You don't have to worry about that. Like it doesn't get in the way of the closing mechanisms because it's so skinny. But it's still quite easy to open and close thanks to this notch part. And now it's available in Adafruit Black.
Okay. Next up, we have
this back.
Standoffs.
This is the Circuit Playground Express bolt-on kit. So you get six M3 12 millimeter long standoffs, and you get 12 M3 5 millimeter screws. The screws, of course, go into the standoff, and these provide both mechanical and electrical connections. So we're using them primarily for things like the Cricut, where you see there's six connections for ground, I2C, audio out, and one data line and V out. So these six connections give you the mechanical connection as well as the electrical connection for the Circuit Playground to the Cricut board itself. So for boards like the Gemma, the Flora, the Circuit Playground Express, even the Microbit, these are items that have these large holes in them. You can use a bolt-on kit to connect it to something else and also make it like nice and rigid.
All right. Next up, tools for LockSport.
LockSport tools. We have two of these, so maybe we'll show both of them and then I'll just demo both at once.
Sure.
So we have a really fancy kit. This one has like hardened steel, like a spring steel that feels really good, and it has riveted handles, comes with a little case. And you get 12 picks and I think three wrenches. And then the other kit is a more basic kit with stamped metal. Stamped metal and little rubber holders. And it's a 9-piece set. So I think it's, 9 picks and 2 wrenches. So The fancier one is fancier, but the basic one is pretty good, and the basic one is what we included in the Ada Box 9, so I can show this off. So if you're interested in Lock Sport, you're like, hey, I've learned about this thing where you basically, I like to describe it as doing a Rubik's Cube with your eyes closed. You know, learning how to pick a lock is just a really fun skill that, like, you'll learn to listen to your fingers. And it takes a lot of patience, so you'll definitely learn that. We do recommend starting with a basic lock, like this clear padlock that we have, that again was also an Ada Box 7. It's a great practice lock. You know, we particularly like these you know, simple picks, but you get, you know, a rake and you get a couple different feelers, and this one doesn't actually have any rakes, but the fancy kit does, because they're a little bit more difficult to manufacture. You get a bunch of different rakes, like a wavy rake here and another wavy rake here. So these are a little bit more wavy style. These are a little bit more feely style. So, you know, you can have different styles. But both have pretty thin, strong picks that you can go in and you can learn to feel the tumbler of your lock. And starting with a lock like this is really good because you can see what's happening. You know, as I push the pins, you can see them move up and down. And then as you gain experience, you can then go to your hardware store and then either just ask them, hey, do you have any locks that don't have keys? And maybe they'll just give you some, or look in your attic or basement and maybe you'll have some padlocks or locks that you've lost keys to. Or of course you can just buy one. Start with like the cheaper ones because they're usually a little easier to pick, and then move your way up. And then one thing I really like is hacker spaces and maker spaces tend to have events called Lock Sport events, where you know, there's competitions where three people sit down and they have to pick three locks at the same time and who does it fastest.
Yeah, the Girl Scouts have events where they do learn the code and Lock Sport.
Totally. Yeah. No, it's super fun. Yeah. And you know, if you ever, you know, get locked out of your apartment or something, or I got locked out of a cabinet once and it was like really handy. I didn't have the keys to a filing cabinet that I owned. I just, you know, I lost the keys. It's handy, but yeah, makerspaces and hackerspaces and conventions have events that you can then take part in, especially if you have a little bit of practice. So we have a couple of different parts so you can join in this Lock Sport. So this is the basic kit, and then I can show the fancy kit real fast. Let me just put this away. Yeah, the fancy kit has a way nicer feel. The metal is much stiffer. So it'll last a lot longer. Like, it's springier because it's not stamped from, I think this is like stainless steel that's then blackened or like anodized. But you get a lot of different shapes, like these, you know, unusual shapes, as well as, of course, your standard feelers and triangle tips. And then you get different wrenches. You get some flexible wrenches. And then this is a really great wrench. This is like nice and strong, but very thin. So you can get into all sorts of locks. And for thicker locks, you can use this double-headed torsion wrench. So all this Lock Sport, you can handle.
All right, next up, Lady Ada.
This is the PIR key. So I actually put this in the store, and then at the very last second decided, you know what, I want to upgrade these to 3.0. So they're coming soon. They'll be in the store soon. This is a device that has CircuitPython running on it. It has only one input, an infrared remote receiver, and an RGB LED. And the idea behind this is that running CircuitPython, you can take infrared remote input. Infrared remotes are everywhere. You don't need certifications. You don't have to pair them. They have no passwords. But if you want to control a computer or a tablet or a phone, you can plug the PIR key in, program it to type in certain key commands or move the mouse in a certain way whenever it receives an IR command. You know, Chris Young does a lot of accessibility tech with IR, which I thought was really inspiring. But I also see other people do projects where just it's easy to blast IR across the room or to a project that's far away. And this is very low cost. So it'll work with any computer, even if it doesn't have Bluetooth, even if it
this
doesn't
have...
This
is neat. It's like a universal accessibility device. It's also Python.
Yeah.
And it just shows up as a drive.
As a keyboard and a drive. The drive has a code on it and the keyboard...
So technically this is another one of our CircuitPython board.
It is a CircuitPython board, and it was, you know, the IR key was originally not programmable because it has an ABR, and so it was like, well, you can't easily pre-program it. So it had to come with a remote. You can only use it with a remote. With this, you can use it with any IR device.
Yeah.
Anything that's about 38 kilohertz, which is like pretty much everything. You read the raw pulses, you paste it into the example code that we provide,
yeah.
And then you can select what key commands you want to send. We have multimedia key support now.
This is great for assistive technology because there's so many things that if you could just use a remote control and have these like macros already set up to type in or move a mouse or do something for you. This is a good idea.
So this is the PIR key. So the P stands for Python.
That makes sense. Okay.
So yeah, we got that in the store. It's basically like a little trinket, but it's just infrared in it.
And then the star of the show tonight, besides Mike and you and our community,
Mike is definitely
the star. Is more blinky.
This is ridiculous. So,
oh yeah,
we wanted to get the ultimate high density LED strip. So this is 120 LEDs at 4 millimeter pitch. It's extremely high pitch. Is pretty much not going to get any higher pitch than that. Like basically, the LEDs are close or are placed, you know, back to back. I think it's actually even maybe a little bit less than four. Maybe it's 3 millimeter.
It's bright.
So we basically requested the factory that makes LED strips to manufacture this for us. And what's cool is that it's actually on an aluminum backed PCB. So the back is aluminum, so it acts as a heat sink because otherwise, like, you actually can't drive this many LEDs. Like, it's definitely you can't have it.
Put it under the overhead so we can blow out this camera.
It's not too bright. But it's completely smooth color. Like, you know, unless you're really close, you can't see the dot separation. Because, again, they're 2 millimeter LEDs and they're as close as possible. They're dot stars. So, hold on, let me twist this around. So they have, like, pretty good persistence of vision. It's not, you know, the best persistence of vision, but it's pretty good. It's better than NeoPixels. You can spin it around and have it like draw things out in the air. And each one is 24-bit color, 8 bits red, green, and blue. And you get 128 of these in a row on this aluminum PCB. It's a little bit flexible, but I wouldn't flex it too much. Basically, you know, I can imagine if you're doing any sort of like costuming or environmental or architectural work where you just want to have like perfect adjustable LED gradients, this will definitely do the job for you.
Okay. And with that, Lady Ada, that was new products.
So many pieces.
Okay. Ready?
Yes.
Recap. What do we got this week?
This week, we got this beautiful illustrated book, Ada Twist Scientist. Learn about young Ada and her interest in engineering and building and what happens to her and her family. We've got from AdaBox 7, the Adafruit Black version of this very skinny metal webcam cover. Works great with tablets, phone, even laptops that, look, when they close, they have almost no space between the keyboard and the webcam. You don't have to worry about it. It'll close because this is super, super skinny. We've tested it with all the modern computers. Circuit Playground Express bolt-on kit. We use this in the Cricut. You get 6 bolts, 12 screws. You can mechanically and electrically connect your Circuit Playground Express to the Cricut or another board of your designing. LockSport pick set. So you want to learn how to pick locks so you can take part in LockSport events. We've got two pick sets that go great with our transparent lock. You got the basic kit and the fancy kit. The basic kit has 9 picks, the fancy kit has 12, and it has more exotic shapes. Both are really great for learning lock sport, and then you can take part in competitions and events and have fun with your friends. PIR key, a Python infrared to keyboard converter. You can program it with CircuitPython, use it with any remote control. It reads it and can emit keyboard or mouse signals, and of course, customizable in CircuitPython super easily. And this mind-blowing 128 LED APA 102 dot star strip. These LEDs are as close as possible, and they're on an aluminum-backed PCB for heat dissipation. It doesn't get any more high density than this. The most LEDs. Packed again.
Okie dokie. Okay, don't forget the code is WorldTurtle. That's all the way up to 11:59 p.m. tonight. So we had a guest. We had a bunch of stuff. We're going to do a couple more minutes on the show. So we're going to squeeze in Top Secret, Lady Ada.
Yeah.
You have two things for Top Secret this week. Can't ask questions about this, folks, but Lady Ada is going to tell you what these are.
Well, first, my magic wand.
First up, do you want to show your magic wand first?
No. I mean, I'm going to use my magic wand.
Okay, make this stuff appear. What is this?
We made a version of the Cricut. Well, we have a feather wing Cricut coming. That's already done. Actually, that came before the Circuit Playground Express Cricut, but we wanted to get the Circuit Express done first because we thought it would be more fun. We have a micro:bit version of the Cricut as well.
Okay.
And then for Raspberry Pi, some people asked, well, what about Raspberry Pi? That'd be really handy stuff, too. We made it into a hat because we figured it would be mechanically easier to plug it on top than have something that goes underneath or it hangs off. But it all fit into a hat shape, and you even have the slots for the camera and display so you can attach accessories and use a seesaw so all of the sensors, motors, analog, NeoPixel, and you don't have to use the Raspberry Pi, which doesn't do robotic control very well or analog input really well. That stuff's taken care of for you.
Okay, and that was top secret. So more.
That's coming out. None of your business.
Yeah.
Don't ask.
So if you're in Discord, start answering each other's questions, or you can ask questions to us. Adafruit.it/Discord. A few questions that I had queued up. This one was for Mike. Would you be able to make that, maybe could you grab the little robot? Would you be able to make this crawl upstairs?
Yeah.
If you could have it lift up and it would stop.
Yeah, those wheels are crawling.
And then maybe this would actually rotate all the way around.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, I don't know.
All right. Tools you use. What do you use?
Tools I use.
Yeah.
It depends on the project. I spend a lot of time in SolidWorks, KeyShot for rendering. Lately, I've been getting back into Alias, which I haven't used for 20 something years. So SpeedForm, which is Autodesk as well. A lot more freeform stuff lately. So, a lot of Alias.
Lady, you started using the latest version of Eagle.
I did, actually.
What's the feature that drew you into it?
It actually does save me a lot of time with the push and shove routing. The fact that when I'm routing these nets together, it automatically puts the traces as close as possible. Because a lot of times I end up spending a few hours just kind of pushing all the traces to be as close as possible to make some room. And EagleCAD now does that basically as I'm routing. So I don't use all of this stuff in it, but that's like the number one thing. Also like via placement and the auto DRC, so I don't have to run DRC over and over again. So that's saving me time. So I'm able to get more of these designs that you're seeing out. And if you look, like the traces are like perfectly bussed together.
Okay. Could you use that as a monitor ambient lighting strip if you're willing to break and solder some things?
You can do whatever you want with this. It's actually about the same width as a monitor. So
yeah. Yeah, that would be a really nice one.
It's hecka bright.
Okay. Next up, for the PIR key, is it receive, transmit, or both?
It's receive IR and transmit keyboard.
Okay.
Maybe in the future we'll make one with IR transmit, but for now it's just receive.
For the standoffs, are those included with Cricut?
Yes, the Cricut comes with them. But if people are making their own boards or, I don't know, I thought they would be a handy thing just to have for people. I know the Microbit, for example, also has holes in the flora. Maybe you're making your own like biscuit designs. Then having these standoffs I thought was handy. And then what's nice is that, six of them, which is 1/3 of the number of pins. So if you just buy as many as you need to fill out the design you've got.
Okay. Do you guys sell PEMs? You know, the threaded inserts?
PEMs? No, we don't.
No. Not yet.
No.
No, they're great for 3D printing. So you can just press them in and you can...
Maybe we'll get some. We have quarter 20, like we have for...
For the camera. Remember
for the camera,
quarter 20,
yeah.
But I was thinking like a number 4 PEM.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you need a permit to own the lockpick sets? No, but do check your latent local and state laws. I mean, basically anyone can buy bolt cutters too. So it's pretty much in that category. These are meant for lock sport. You're not going to use these. Like, if you can watch Ocean's 11 all you want, but that's it's not like that.
People don't really.
So this is for people who do events. Like I said, my favorite one is the Learn to Code Girl Scout thing that I saw, and they pick locks.
I think this is for people who want to have fun doing lock sport.
Yeah.
Don't do anything bad with these. You're not going to anyways, because honestly, it's a lot easier to just break a window. If you were going to break into a supply.
Yeah, this is kind of like any tool.
Yeah.
You know, saws or bolt cutters are available.
Yeah.
And those are far easier that's what people will use if they want to get into a lock.
It's easier to kick the door.
And way faster.
Someone asked, can they send PCB files to us and would we make PCBs? No, but you should check out Oshpark, because that's the place. If you don't know about Oshpark, Google it, look it up. It's at oshpark.com. And that's the perfect purple PCBs that you see a lot. Okay. Single channel NeoPixel breakout level shipping boards for 3.3 logic based boards. Sorry, I had to ask.
We don't have any.
Don't have any. Okay. All right. Oh, as someone else mentioned, there's something called a bump key. It's kind of a universal key, and then people put I got one of those at a conference, and you can kind of tap a lock, and it sometimes it works. Okay. Well, I think we got through all the questions.
Okay, great.
All right. Let's give something away. What do you want to give away?
I want to give away, let me see, would be good. I think I want to give away a copy of Ada Twist Scientist.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's a lovely book. And also, maybe you can give it to a friend with a kid.
Okay.
Or a young person in your life.
What's the rules?
Rules are, if you've won something before, you can't win again. Only one winner for my lifetime. The winner is the first person to call a phone number. When it appears on the screen, we turn on the phones. I'm going to ask you your name, where you're calling from, and a project you're working on or you want to work on. If you are able to answer those questions correctly, I will send you out a copy of this book, Ada Twist Scientist.
So to be clear, I don't qualify.
Well, you can just give you, I can just give you a book anyways. I mean, like, you're here.
All right, well.
It'd be kind of funny if you called on your phone.
The phone lines are open.
I don't know where my phone is.
So the phone's right behind you, and it should ring. Yeah. So Lady A, get ready.
I'm getting ready.
Did you two rings?
I'm going to kind of move back a little bit.
Yeah, or else I can switch.
Can I anyway?
You want to switch?
Let's see if anyone. Oh, yeah, you want to switch?
Yeah, okay.
Okay,
switch
let's
time.
See if anyone calls.
Okay, call the phone.
I'm Bitstab's phone number.
Call the number.
Do, 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 do,
win
do,
a
do,
book.
Do, 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 do. I can turn on the phone. Yeah, turn on the phone. We haven't had a week in a long time where no one called.
Actually, someone called from Canada last time I was here.
That's right. Mm. Hold the phone. Yeah.
Should I check the...
No.
Dang.
You try turning it off and on again.
Oh, there you go. See?
All right. Go for it, Lady.
Hello?
Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Can you turn off your computer
Hi.
Audio?
Yeah.
Okay, and when you're done, come back.
Good.
Okay, hi, what's your name and where are you calling from?
My name is Ezra, I'm calling from Florida.
Sorry,
what's
your name?
Ezra.
Okay, well, congratulations, you're the winner of an Ada Twist Scientist book. It's product number 3820, I need to remember that later. What's the project you're working on or you want to work on?
Right now I'm working on actually making a MIDI controlled piano. I'm actually attaching servos to this piece.
Okay, cool. Alright, well, maybe you have someone in your life who would appreciate this book, or maybe you can read it for super fun. All you have to do to win your prize is email support@adafruit.com, support@adafruit.com, and say, hey, I won product number 3820 on Ask Engineer, and they'll send it to you as soon as possible.
Cool.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for calling. Have a great night.
Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Okay, well, that was a trivia question.
That was efficient.
Okay, well, that's our show. Thank you so much, Mike.
Yay!
All right. Well, the next time you come out here, you're going to be able to show all the stuff we probably made for robotics together.
A bunch of stuff while we were online.
That's
of
exactly.
Of course, that's the problem.
Yeah.
Now is your.
Well, when we go, we're going to grab a bite to eat. We can show you some of the things that either we purchased and we're just like, this is too expensive, it's too hard, or some of the things that we just know people can't do with robotics yet until they have all the things that can make it easy for them. So
I was
sort of
working through the stair climbing while we're.
Now you want to make a stair climbing button.
I was just thinking, make it in the shape of an axe, so it can just.
Oh yeah,
anything.
There's lots of things.
All right.
A snake. I think someone made a comment about being a snake. I like that.
Code World Turtle all the way up to 1159. Thank you, everyone out there. Special thanks to all the Adafruit community members, everyone in Discord, all the Adafruit team members here and far, and thank you everybody for supporting this fun stuff. Oh, you know what? One thing that Nist just mentioned. That I really like that we did. So your name is actually on the cases because you're the designer of them.
Yeah.
And I remember when we first did that, I think there was people in the community or I think someone told you or I don't know the details of the story. They're like, wow, I can't believe they let you put your name on it, which is
a lot.
And the way I look at it is just like open source, that this is kind of all we have. It's like that's your design, and it's also something you can get from Adafruit.
Nice.
So I thought that was neat. It'd be cool if there was, you know, designed in Cupertino, cool. But wouldn't it be neat if you could see some of the names of the people? They used to do that with computers back in the day.
Well, I have the old Macs where they have the team engraved on the inside of the
keyboard. And it's really special.
But you have to open the machine to see that.
Right? Still, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
It's
still cool. So I think that I think that'll be neat, and we'll always carry on that tradition for the stuff you do, especially, you know, with some of these cool parts.
I have had clients say, can you not put your name on
it? Oh, because we ruined it. They're like, look, does your name have to be on everything?
Is that the rule? No, writer.
I don't want your name on it.
It'd be neat if there was like a pile of pie cases and someone's like, well, which one's yours? And you're like, the one with my name on it. Because your name's on it. Yeah.
I've done that.
Okay.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
We'll be here next week, 8 p.m. Ask an Engineer. We do this every week. And here is your moment of Zener.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
I noticed we're like, Stella keeps saying.
Here we are. We're up there.